Jack the Stripper actually killed 8 prostitute victims. She was found dead at Duke's Meadow, just like Elizabeth Figg. He has taken all of the latest 3 victims' teeth out. He's taken their front 2-3 teeth out, 2-3-4 teeth, as a trophy. And the last 4 of the victims, they all had tiny specks of spray paint on their clothing. Hello and welcome to Kushti TV, always the straight talking YouTube channel where my specialist subjects are boxing and golf. But I've recently been told off a little bit by my close friend and advisory Martin. He said I must be a little bit more diversified in my work. So a little bit more diversity is going in. And the areas I quite like, I don't like the happenings and the goings on of what happened, but we are a nation that are intrigued with true crime. So today's podcast, TV, shall we call it, is going to be about true crime. Yes, so if I said to you, true crime and Jack the Ripper, of course you would all know who Jack the Ripper is, from 18-year-olds to 80-year-olds. But if I said to you, Jack the Stripper, you might think I'm gimmicking a bit here. Some of you will be aware of it. A lot of you won't be. Now, what I found a bit mystified about it was I didn't come across this knowledge of Jack the Stripper murders until some 15, 20 years ago. Fairly recent. Now, ever since I've been a little boy, I was aware of Jack the Ripper, but not Jack the Stripper. Well, Jack the Ripper killed 5 prostitute victims in East London. Jack the Stripper actually killed 8 prostitute victims in West London. So, you know, a wealthy sort of leafy part of West London, up and around the Thames, 8 murders, and it didn't get anywhere near the notoriety of the 5 murders in the slums of East London. Okay, they were about 70 years apart. Of course, Jack the Ripper was 1890 something, and these murders were started late 50s and into the mid 60s. So, okay, before we start, let's bring in the times and the victims. Before we start, let's always be vigilant and thoughtful and respectful to the poor, sad victims who they lost their lives at a young age, and some left children behind, sisters, brothers, and potentially even elderly parents could even still be alive today. So a sad little thought and a prayer on these victims before we go in and find out who they are. And victim one was a lady named Elizabeth Figg. She was aged 21 and she tried to better her life. She came from Cheshire, northwest England. And sadly, on the 17th of June in 1959, in a place called Duke's Meadow, it had a nickname of Lover's Lane, and a place where prostitutes would ply some of their work. And if you don't know that part of London so well, I do. I was born, this is why I'm slightly intrigued, I was born in that side of London, just off the Thames, and we just come up a little bit. Duke's Meadow is better known as the Mortlake Bridge, where the boat race finishes. So a body was literally found just yards from where the winning post for the world famous boat race. So at this stage, Elizabeth Figg was found dead, partly nude, by the Mortlake Bridge, Duke's Meadow. And it was maybe arguably a dispute with a punter, something that the police paid not much more attention and reason to of that, really. That was it. It disappeared, and she wasn't part of a serial killing. She was just a victim of some work had gone wrong. Some 4 years had passed on the 8th of November 1963. Victim number two was Gwyneth Rees, age 22, from Bury in Wales. She was found dead in Townmead Road in Mortlake, just 40 yards from the Thames. So 4 years apart, serial killer, nothing's put together. At this stage, they were both prostitutes, they were both young women, victim of a dispute, crime. Police were trying to piece together motives, but of course there was no connection. And sadly, this just was swept under the carpet for the time being, until victim number three was found. Yes, on the 2nd of February 1964, third victim, Anna Telford, would be found dead on the west side of Hammersmith Bridge, laying next to the Thames. Yes, Anna was a small, pretty petite lady, made her way down from the north, east of England, Northumberland, to try and better her life, and sadly, her life ended there. Now, speculation started as to why she died, but still there was no hard connection to a serial killer. Bear in mind, our first victim, Elizabeth Figg, was about 4 years before the second victim, and no patterns emerging, no cement. No hard evidence, nothing cemented to prove the fact that he's a serial killer. Irene Lockwood, aged just 25, a petite, pretty lady, made her way down from the North Midlands, Nottinghamshire, to better her life. And sadly, on the 8th of April 1964, she was found dead at Duke's Meadow, just like Elizabeth Fig. And yes, as I said earlier, the bridge where the boat race finishes, Mortlake, Duke's Meadow. Now, only at this stage had eyebrows be starting to be raised, and there's now becoming a fair chance that there's a serial killer out there. The first gap had taken away some of that suspicion, but now we have got victim number four in the very same spot as victim number one, and of course two more just very close by. So at this stage, an highly accomplished Scotland Yard detective by the nickname of Four-Day Johnny, John DuRose, is drafted in. DuRose is 4 Day Johnny for getting crime solved within 4 days of them happening, yeah? So, he's got a great track record, and they now start, for the first time, believe they have a serial killer out there on the loose. And his job, if he can stop him in 4 days, that would be good, and we wouldn't have any victim number five. But so sadly, we did. So victim number five was Helen Barth Ellamy, who died, who was found dead, Boston Manor Road, Brentford, on April the 24th, 1964. So, Boston Manor Road, I know very well, not far from the Thames, slightly inland. Doesn't lead all the way up to the Thames, but not far. Yes, she made her way down from Scotland, trying to find a better life, and sadly she met Jack the Stripper. And it also sadly ended at that tender young age. Now, the pattern is moving. You know, we got to victim number four when four-day Johnny John DeRose was drafted in to solve these crimes. And shortly after number four, number five victim, the fifth victim, Ellen Bartolome. Yeah, now what really is starting to become striking, all of these victims are averaging around 5 foot in length. Yeah, they're all averaging between 20 and 30, so they're all young, they're all petite, they're all pretty, and none of them are homegrown. When I say homegrown, none of them are from London. They're all from up the road a bit. So you've got to start thinking by now, this Jack the Stripper serial killer is targeting a specific type of woman, that and pretty, petite. They're all prostitutes, of course, and they're all up the road. I'm wondering if he's thinking it'll be much harder to detect their loss as their parents, family, brothers, sisters, etc. are not, you know, on local turf. Okay, yeah, so this is a striking and striking resemblance to Hall, and the other fact is that he has taken all of the latest three victims' teeth out. He's taken their front two, three, four teeth, as a trophy. So at this stage, four-day Johnny hasn't kept up his four-day Johnny work. He is John DeRose. He's getting a man, proud police officer with a great reputation, one of Scotland Yard's leading. You know, so he's really upped the ante now, and he's up the stakes, and he has put on a huge amount of police officers, day and night, on the case to find the culprit, Jack the Stripper. He's doing roadblocks, just as we're seeing with the Yorkshire Ripper some decade or so after. There was roadblocks, so he was stopping drivers going over the Thames and coming back between a certain time period, because all the girls went missing post 11 p.m. and were all found prior to 6 p.m. So there's that gap in the window where the cars are going across the Thames to and from, and yeah, all the victims are being picked up in West London and at various points you have to cross the Thames, come back. And yeah, so they're really going for a painstakingly fine tooth comb attempt to find Jack the Stripper. But sadly, that wouldn't stop victim number six. Yes, on the 14th of July in Berrymead Road, Chiswick, victim number six, Mary Fleming, a 30-year-old from Clyde Bank in Scotland, had made her way through the glamorous life in London. Sadly, she met Jack the Stripper, and it wouldn't be so glamorous for the again petite, pretty 30-year-old again, who would be found dead with some of her front teeth missing. So 4 day Johnny John DeRose is on the back foot, and six victims, and it wouldn't be too much longer before victim number seven, on the 23rd of October 1964 in Aunton Street, Kensington, sadly, from Glasgow in Scotland, age 30, Francis Brown, will be found dead. And it's the very same MO of Jack the Stripper. Dead, partially naked, front teeth missing. Only slight difference here, certainly him, but he's come away from the Thames just a little bit, only about a mile inland from possibly the nearest point being Chelsea. Yeah, the Thames, and is a few miles from the beaten track, only 3 or 4 miles from Chiswick, Hammersmith, Duke's Meadow, Mortlake, around there. So he's just gone up the road a little bit, slightly nearer to the city, but the MO's just the same. sadly, and Francis Brown would meet her end there. And victim number eight, sadly and thankfully, on the 16th of February, Bridget O'Hara would be found dead. And when I say thankfully, she sadly would be the final victim of Jack the Stripper. She was found on the Heron training estate in Acton. Again, a bit more inland, but this Heron training estate will have quite a bit of importance in this case. She was deemed to have been missing for 1 month. And what was unfolding in the final four victims, all the MO was the same. All their teeth missing, they were all pretty, just like the ones before. But in the last four of the victims, they all had tiny specks of spray paint on their clothing. And the Erin Trading Estate in Acton, where she was found, will have a significant fact into who was Jack the Stripper. Okay, so there's the victims. We pause for thought again, but I'm going to bring in to light in a moment all the chief suspects. I'm going to lay the facts bare. I'm going to be contradictory to some professors and a television crew who believe Jack the Stripper's somebody else. But sit back and allow me to bring close in the suspects and let me paint the picture as to who I think and believe was Jack the Stripper. Yes, so there we've seen the sad endings to young, beautiful women trying to make some money and better their life, and the horrendous work of Jack the Stripper. Now, the big question remains, as then, as it does now, who was Jack the Stripper? So we got a couple of slightly diluted, weak, really outside chance characters that fitted into the suspect bill, if you like, and the shortlist description. And one was Kenneth Archibald, partially deaf, described as an oddball character, run a tennis club. He was a caretaker in a tennis club at Duke's Meadow. He walked into a police station, into a London police station, and confessed to killing Irene Lockwood. Boozed up he was. He later retracted, and he went into the Old Bailey, and after just 45 minutes he was acquitted, because this oddball character was looking for some notoriety and fame in the drunken state when confessing, and then when he sobered up he clearly had no knowledge of anything about. So that was one initial suspect, was completely eradicated from it. Another one was never named, but a police officer who had some strange characteristics about himself. He didn't fit in with the Metropolitan Police, and as a result he would go out and stage burglaries. So he'd make the people that he didn't like on his shift all minor burglaries, nothing major, break-ins, setting alarms off, etc. And he was doing all of these, again, oddball little crimes, so that instead of their mates sitting, minding their own business in the shift, they'd have to be actually doing a bit of work. And someone, the Metropolitan Police, actually thought that he could have been a Jack the Stripper, because his antics of all early hour oddball crimes, but there were nothing more, it fizzled out, there were nothing more than a police officer playing boyish games with his mates and creating a little bit of havoc, so they had to work. So he was eliminated. But there were much more stronger suspects come to the forefront. And one of them being, this might really surprise you, and it surprised me, and it's been mentioned on numerous occasions, Freddie Mills, the legendary light heavyweight champion boxer who featured on some of my earlier podcast. Freddie Mills, a journalist, said in a book that the reason he'd taken his own life was because he was about to be caught for the murders of the 8 prostitutes. He was Jack the Stripper. Well, let me explain why. Jimmy Tippett Jr., son of a gangster. I think Jimmy might be a gangster himself, I'm not sure, but he's written a book. And he said it was common knowledge that Freddie Mills was Jack the Stripper. People like the Craze, the Richardsons, Mad Frankie Fraser, all knew that Freddie was going out killing these girls. It's common knowledge. Well, let me address a couple of things. Freddie was from the other side of the water, quite some distance. It wasn't on his patch where the killings happened. That doesn't mean to say that he can't drive from Southwark over the water some 8 to 10 miles and commit these murders. Of course that's possible, feasible. Yeah, that's possible. But somebody knew the area really well. It was their stomping ground. Yeah, they knew the area really well. They lived there. But I don't really, this doesn't really eliminate Freddie properly, does it? This is just not his area. But what will eliminate Freddie properly is that people like the Craze, the Richardsons, the Nashes, Mad Frankie Fraser. I mean, these are vicious people, but they were vicious people to vicious people. They didn't take their work to civilians, if you like. And they were meant to be staunch people. These are proper people. Yeah, these are staunch fellas. Come on, these are proper stand-up fellas. So them knowing that somebody's committing a crime against innocent women, they would allow Freddie Mills to carry on and do this on 8 occasions. If he'd done it after twice, they might have shot him in the head. But come on, which boys in the world are going to knowingly know somebody's committing murder to innocent women? Come on, let's get it real. We're boys, we're faces around town. Come on, you know, I've been around the block, got some t-shirts myself. You don't, come on, let's be real about this. You don't stand on the sidelines and allow somebody to murder innocent women. You've either got to eradicate them by force, or the authorities have to be alerted, yeah? You can't grass a serial killer, can you? Well, can you? Come on, it's killing innocent people. But these blokes didn't probably need to grass. They could put one in his nut. Okay, met that end. But that's another ending. Freddie had taken his own life, I truly believe, and zero involvement. He would have been eradicated by the boys, by the firm, way before that. Freddie Mills' involvement in this, to me, 1,000,000%, zero, nonsense. People saying stuff to maybe try and sell books. Yeah, but absolutely nonsense. Not possible. The boys would not have known he was killing innocent women and allowed him to get away with it. He wouldn't have done it a third time if they knew it happened twice, trust me. So, Freddie Mills, out of it. No way. Wrong side of London, and the boys wouldn't have allowed it. But, sorry for even bringing your name into it, Freddie. You're so far from this crime. But a couple of people have, so I'm just freeing your ear, me old mate. Long live the light heavyweight champion, but never in a million years. Yes, so the highest remaining, the most suspicious suspect lay in that of a gentleman by the name of Errol Jones. I probably shouldn't refer to him as a gentleman. he's passed on. And he certainly wasn't a gentleman as a young teenager. He had been convicted for murdering an 11-year-old and an 8-year-old girl. I think he was aged 15, possibly 16, when these murders had taken place. He initially got off on the first murder, and he then got charged with the second murder. And when he got charged with the second murder, he got, you know, the torture was back on him for the first murder, which he then admitted. And he would have faced the hangman's noose in these days. The crimes happened in Wales, but for he was too young, and he was sentenced to prison. And it was deemed in prison he potentially could live an happy life thereafter and even bring up a family. He was given a new identity, released from Wandsworth Prison, and he was settled in West London, released in 1941. Yes. Professor David Wilson is a man I love watching. I haven't met him, I love watching his TV. Oh, clever man. Yeah, professor, journalist, very good, very impressed. But him and his team are fairly convinced that Harold Jones is the man responsible as Jack the Stripper. Harold Jones lives a couple roads away from one of the victims, one of the 8 victims. And yeah, he was living in Fulham, which again, in West London, is right by the Thames. So he's in the prime area. Yeah, he's got some, he actually stated that he never lost the urge to kill when he was under some rehabilitation therapy, I'm led to believe. So that you can really see why he is an eye suspect, and they're working on the case as we speak. He lived in that area, and from 1962 to 1965, nobody could really find his whereabouts, which I find strange, you know. Not finding his whereabouts for 3 years. What happened? Did he live in an address that wasn't registered to him or something? We don't really know. But for me, I'm using layman's terms, if you like, ABC, 1, 2, 3. My opinion, I'm laying the facts here. And I do not believe that that child murderer is the murderer of the 8 pretty young women. No, I don't think it's him. Why? Right, okay, I'll tell you why. He is released from prison in 1941. He's given a new identity, as I said, in West London. He does marry, he does have family. Now, he's gone some 18 years, so it's nearly 2 decades. I'm not saying he hasn't committed crime, but he's been guilty of nothing. Zero crime, yeah, from 1941 to 1959. So 18 years have passed. Furthermore, people, human beings, have aggressive appetites and for violence, no matter what their area of violence are, if it's for murdering prostitutes or having a fight in a pub. It's fact that people get to an age and they start mellowing, and their aggression and their want to hurt others, it dampens and dies right down. And the average age for a serial killer is somewhere between 20s and 40s. And if Harold Jones was the serial killer, he would have been, I think, the oldest serial killer in British history, because by the time Bridget O'Hara was found dead in 1965, he would have been in his 60th year. So these are the facts. He's got no record for 18 years, it's almost 2 decades. Zero trouble with the police. And then suddenly, he starts up as one of the world's oldest serial killers. And for that reason, he died 1971 in his 65th year. For that reason, that's just not making any sense. 2 decades, nothing, yeah? Just raising a family, going about your business. Now you're getting towards the end of your life. You know, life expectancy was a little bit less then, not usually. But he's getting towards the latter part of his life and he starts up being a serial killer when he's sort of heading for pipe and slippers, if you like. As I say, the last murder, Bridget O'Hara, he'd have been in his 60th year. So for that reason, 2 decades out, nothing, too old, he is not the prime suspect. I think Jack the Stripper was a gentleman by the name of Mungo Island. That's who I think he is. Who is Mungo Island? Well, I don't know who Mungo Island is, except from doing some study on this case, these murders. He come from Dundee. I know the town of Dundee, beautiful town. Dundee, just outside of Edinburgh. Yeah, he come from Dundee, made his way to London. And what we do know is that John DeRose, 4 Day Johnny, had deliberately put out a profile and he went to the press and he said, well, he narrowed it down to 20, now down to 15, now down to 10, now down to 5. Anyway, he had his eye on a suspect called Mungo Island. Now, the profile fitted Mungo Island's opportunities because the victims were missing from 11 p.m. and found 5 a.m. and Mungo Island had a job shift. Wait for this. Had a job shift pattern. He was a security guard at the Heron Trading Estate where Bridget O'Hara's body was found. So he was a security guard and his time shift was, he started at 10 p.m. yeah, and he finished at 6 a.m. So it was a perfect opportunity. He fitted that. Coincidental that he worked in the same estate. He had access to these tiny spots of paint that were found on the bodies, as I said earlier. Mungo Island had access to the premises where the very specks of paint were coming off of a dynamo, like an electric motor, to power something. It was at the back of a spray shed. So you can imagine somebody going about their daily business as a sprayer, spraying numerous of that, you know, amounts of colours, etc., etc., and it would blow through onto this dynamo. And yeah, so he had access to that. He worked on that estate, and Bridget O'Hara's body had the same specks of paint. She was out on the Erin Trading Estate. An ex-amateur boxer, I'm led to believe, Mungo Island. As 4 Day Johnny, DeRose announced he was down to his final man. Mungo Island was due into Acton Magistrates Court on a minor motoring offence, failing to stop while striking a vehicle. He was known to use the services of prostitutes, and on the day he was due in to court, he had left a suicide note to his wife saying that he couldn't stick it anymore. Tell the police, I'll be in the garage, that's where you and the police can find me. And he put an exhaust pipe through, started it up and killed himself with carbon monoxide poisoning. Now, I can't help but think, just further to cement my suspicions on Mungo Island, he was from Dundee, yeah, Fife in Scotland, just outside Edinburgh. Now, his last 4 victims, yeah, were Scottish, 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 and Irish. You know, was that coincidental? And also, North England, Northumberland's not a million miles from Scotland, it's a fairly bordering part, so it's heading up towards the border. All of these girls were away from, as I say, that none of them were local London girls. They'd all come from, 3 from Scotland, 1 from Ireland, a couple from North England, 1 in Wales. They all come to try and make better for themselves, but they were all, they all I just find it, I don't know how you, they all fit in the MO of somebody who's saying, right, these girls won't be found so easily if they're from up the road. And don't you think it will make very easy conversation? This might be coincidental, or she's just made. Do you not think it will make easy conversation for a Scottish person to speak to a Scottish person, or a Scottish person to speak to somebody nearly from Scotland? Yeah. Of course, could it ever be proven? We're not sure. But for me, Mungo Island, the perfect opportunity in terms of the timing, the shift pattern, the body of Bridget O'Hara found with specks of paint, the suicide note, I can't stick it anymore, you and the police. Not you can find me, you and the police can find me in the garage. Of course, when Mungo Island had committed suicide, the killings had stopped. Yeah, so there we have it. For me, it was Mungo Island. For Four Day Johnny, John DuRose, it was, he said in a book in 1970 that he had his man, and he had no to little doubt that it was Mungo Island. A couple of facts: that his job opportunity worked on the Erin trading estate in Acton, where Bridget O'Hara's body was found, and he had access to the area where the dynamo wood, the spray spots were on. So 10 p.m., 6 a.m., body found there. Suicide note: I can't stick this anymore. You and the police can find me in the garage. Not you, meaning his wife or his family, you and the police can find me in the garage. Can't stick it anymore. And I can't help thinking that three of his victims in a row were Scottish. And I know there's, let's get this right, I know there's not any pattern, but there is a bit of a pattern here. Can you just imagine how easy it is for a Scottish person in London to speak to another Scottish person? You know, where are you from? Oh yeah, I know that area, etc, etc, I have a cousin and so on. You know, and he's completely won the trust of these people. Yeah, and three of them, I find it ironic, three, he's fifth, sixth and seventh victim, they're all from Scotland, and he's eighth from Ireland, and then from Northumberland, which is almost a border town to England and Scotland, and none of them were from London, they were all from up the road. And I think for me, Mungo Island had selected these people with certain accents, knowing that it would be harder to be for family and stuff to trace them, because there's none there. They're from Scotland, Ireland, Northumberland, Wales, Nottinghamshire. Yeah, so for me, it's Mungo Island, Harold Jones, too old, too many decades without getting any trouble, Freddie Mills nonsense, the other oddballs we know, we're just oddballs. Okay, thanks for tuning in, and we'll look forward to speaking some more next time. Please remember to click and subscribe. I'll keep giving you content, you keep on subscribing. Bye for now.